You know, for anyone who's been watching your selections on our Icons of Italy YouTube channel, there's one comment that really jumped out at us.
Oh, yeah. What was that?
Someone wrote, and I'm quoting here, "Before Federico Faggin, Silicon Valley was just a valley." Let's just like sit with that for a second. It's a bold statement, right?
It is bold. Wow. But it really makes you think.
It does.
Io ho speso 30 anni a studiare la coscienza. Loro non hanno speso neanche un'ora a studiare la coscienza, ma ci dicono cos'è la coscienza. Quindi voglio che ci sia serietà scientifica nello studio della coscienza, cosa che gli scienziati oggi non vogliono.
That single line, coming from one of you, our listeners, it truly captures the, well, the monumental impact of Federico Faggin, pronounced Faggin, by the way.
Right, Faggin. Important point.
Yeah, I mean, here's a guy who not only invented the microchip and the touchpad, but was also, like, a pioneer in the very early stages of neural networks. He's, you know, a global icon, and his innovations have fundamentally altered how we live and connect.
Absolutely, and for our international audience, you know, for all of you who share that deep appreciation for Italy, Faggin's story is such a powerful embodiment of Italian ingenuity and groundbreaking vision. It's a narrative filled with moments of just sheer brilliance, incredible determination, and those, well, unexpected twists that make a life truly captivating.
Exactly. So in this deep dive, based on the sources you shared with us, we're not just going to list his achievements. Our mission is to really understand Federico Faggin, the person, his core humanity, the driving forces behind his ascent to global fame, and those pivotal, almost shocking moments that shifted his perspective and changed the course of his journey. We're looking at a deeply engaging and yet, at times, profoundly moving story.
And to do this, we've explored a range of material, including some fascinating firsthand accounts from Faggin himself that you highlighted from YouTube. So yeah, get ready, because this is a remarkable story. Okay, let's go right back to the beginning.
Yeah.
Imagine Italy during wartime, the world that the young Federico entered.
Yeah, it was a world undergoing, well, immense transformation. He experienced firsthand both the traditional agricultural way of life and the burgeoning industrial revolution. This gave him a really unique vantage point on societal change, a perspective that, honestly, few individuals could possess. What do you think it was like for him, you know, witnessing those two worlds colliding?
It must have been incredibly formative. I mean, definitely. And even as a young boy, his mind was already fascinated by how things worked, wasn't it? That intense passion for vehicles, especially airplanes, that desire to understand the mechanics, the inner workings, it really foreshadows the engineering powerhouse he was to become. It's like his curiosity was already taking flight, you know?
It's fascinating, isn't it, that he herself humorously observed that he found it easier to understand machines than people. That gives us a real insight into his analytical mind, his comfort in the logical and predictable realm of engineering. Did that strike you as particularly telling?
It really did, yeah. And talk about following your own path. His father, a philosopher, likely envisioned a different intellectual pursuit for his son. But Federico's innate drive towards the technical clearly won out, leading him to pursue those studies.
Yeah.
That takes a certain kind of conviction, doesn't it?
Absolutely, and that decision proved pivotal. His early work experience at Olivetti at just 18, designing and building experimental computers using transistors in the early 1960s, that was absolutely crucial hands-on learning. This wasn't just abstract theory, it was real-world application of the most cutting-edge technology of the time. Imagine being at the forefront of that revolution at such a young age.
It's like he was getting an insider's view into the future, basically. But he didn't stop there. He recognized the immense potential of these transistors and decided to delve even deeper into the underlying science.
Exactly. He returned to the University of Padua to study physics, focusing on solid-state physics and quantum mechanics, the fundamental principles that govern how transistors work. He wasn't just interested in how to use them, he wanted to understand why they behaved the way they did. And graduating in under 4 years with top honors, wow, that really underscores his intense intellectual drive. What a foundation to build upon.
And this is where it gets really interesting for me. That deep dive into the quantum world, that fundamental understanding, it all came together just 8 years later when he designed his first microprocessor. It's like he was meticulously assembling the pieces of a puzzle that the rest of the world hadn't even, like, conceived of yet.
Precisely. And that journey continued when he joined SGS Fairchild in Italy. Now, as you pointed out, this company had strong connections to Fairchild Semiconductor, right in the heart of what would soon become Silicon Valley. So it was a significant step, wasn't it?
Definitely a crucial connection. And his work developing MOS technology for SGS Fairchild was so impactful that it earned him a trip to the U.S. in 1968, initially planned for just 6 months. And we all know how that turned out.
Indeed. Yeah, that six-month trip became permanent and for good reason. In that same year, 1968, while at Fairchild, he developed silicon gate technology. Now, for those of you who might not be deeply technical, think of it this way. MOS technology was a way to build tiny switches called transistors, the building blocks of electronics. Silicon gate technology was a significant improvement on that, making these switches more efficient and easier to manufacture reliably. Faggin saw the potential of MOS transistors for miniaturization, even though they weren't initially popular due to speed and production challenges. His insight was key. What's fascinating here is that even though MOS transistors weren't initially popular due to speed and production challenges, Faggin saw their future potential.
He had that crucial foresight, didn't he? He saw the underlying simplicity as the path to miniaturization and believed those initial hurdles could be overcome. It's like he had an intuitive grasp of where the technology needed to evolve. And it wasn't long before a new and pivotal opportunity presented itself.
Yes, the early 1970s saw him move to Intel. Now, you often hear it said that the invention of the microprocessor was inevitable, given the existence of computers and integrated circuits. But think about that for a moment. Saying that is like saying a car was inevitable after the invention of the wheel. The critical missing component, the engine that would drive the revolution, was Faggin's groundbreaking silicon gate technology.
Right, and he didn't just refine the technology. He took it and applied it to the incredibly complex task of designing a central processing unit, a CPU, on a single chip. It's one thing to have a better building material, it's another to architect an entirely new kind of structure with it. How monumental was that leap?
Oh, it was a truly monumental feat. Imagine connecting thousands upon thousands of transistors onto one tiny sliver of silicon. It required not only brilliant design, but also the development of the entire manufacturing process for silicon gate, a brand new technology at the time. He was essentially inventing on multiple fronts simultaneously.
And all of this was happening under intense pressure, wasn't it? Intel at that stage lacked the in-house expertise for this custom project for a Japanese calculator company, Busicom. They were really, like, relying on Faggin's innovation.
Totally. What's really revealing about his character is his approach. His primary contribution wasn't just fulfilling the contractual obligations, it was conceiving the most sophisticated design possible, specifically to demonstrate the power and superiority of silicon gate technology. He wasn't just creating a chip for a calculator, he was showcasing the future of computing. That takes a certain vision and, well, boldness.
And then we had that iconic moment in mid-January 1971. The first working 4004 microprocessors were produced. Can you even imagine the feeling of witnessing that?
It must have been an absolutely electrifying moment. His excited phone call to his wife, Elvia, it works. It's such a simple human expression of a profound breakthrough. It wasn't just a technical victory. It was the culmination of immense dedication and relentless effort. What do you think went through his mind at that moment?
I can only imagine the sense of exhilaration, the realization that he had just created something truly revolutionary. And he recognized the sheer significance of it, didn't he? He understood that this wasn't just a new component. It was the dawn of a new era, a technology that would fundamentally change how the world operated.
Crucially, and this really speaks to his visionary thinking, he convinced Intel that they should sell the microprocessors to anyone who wanted them, not just Busicom. He saw the far-reaching potential beyond that single custom project. He knew this was a game changer with implications that no one could fully grasp yet.
And for Federico, the 4004 wasn't the end of the road. It was just the beginning of his journey in the microprocessor world. He went on to design four generations of microprocessors at Intel, including the groundbreaking 808, the first 8-bit processor, and the 8080, Intel's first second-generation microprocessor. He was at the very forefront of this incredible revolution.
Then in 1974, fueled by that dynamic Silicon Valley spirit of, you know, respecting and empowering founders, he made the bold decision to leave Intel and establish his own company, Zilog Inc. What do you think motivated that entrepreneurial leap?
It seems like a natural progression for someone with his drive and vision. I mean, he'd seen the impact of his creations firsthand and likely had even bigger ideas he wanted to pursue independently. And Zilog Z80 CPU. I mean, that became a true workhorse, a massive bestseller that incredibly remains in production even today, over four decades later. That's a real testament to its ingenious design and enduring legacy.
The company's growth was phenomenal, rocketing from just 11 employees to 1,100 in a mere 3 years. That kind of hypergrowth brings its own set of intense challenges and demands, marking a new and demanding chapter in his entrepreneurial journey. It's almost hard to fathom that pace of expansion.
But he wasn't content with just revolutionizing the CPU market. In 1986, he co-founded Synaptics with a truly groundbreaking idea, creating neural networks that would enable computers to learn on their own. At the time, that was considered quite a fringe concept, wasn't it?
It was definitely outside the mainstream of AI research at the time. The prevailing approaches were largely symbolic, but Faggin, in collaboration with Carver Mead of Caltech, saw the potential of these biologically inspired networks, and remarkably, history proved him correct about a decade later when deep learning took off. He was ahead of the curve once again.
And while at Synaptics, he and his team achieved another truly transformative innovation, the invention of the touchpad and the touchscreen. These technologies have completely changed how we interact with our mobile devices. Can you even imagine our modern world without them?
It's almost impossible to conceive of.
Right.
And there's that rather amusing anecdote about Steve Jobs initially telling him the touchscreen technology was interesting, but took up too much space. It just goes to show that even the most visionary leaders can sometimes have initial reservations about truly disruptive technologies. It makes you wonder how many other potentially revolutionary ideas have been initially dismissed.
Despite all this incredible and world-changing success, a different kind of questioning began to emerge for him, didn't it? He started grappling with fundamental questions about the very nature of consciousness. What do you think sparked that shift in focus?
It seems that observing the lack of a satisfactory explanation for consciousness within the prevailing neuroscience literature, despite the detailed understanding of brain activity, began to deeply trouble him. He started to question the core tenets of materialism, the idea that consciousness is simply a product of physical matter. It's a profound shift from the tangible world of engineering to the more abstract realm of philosophy and metaphysics. And if you're enjoying this deep dive into the incredible journey of an Italian icon, why not take a moment to like, comment, and subscribe to our channel for more fascinating stories?
Then came what he describes as a truly pivotal experience, often referred to as his awakening, in December 1990 at Lake Tahoe. This wasn't a gradual intellectual shift. It was a profound, deeply personal, and transformative event.
He recounts a powerful surge of energy emanating from his chest, an overwhelming feeling of love, joy, and profound peace, unlike anything he had ever experienced before. This single intense event became a major turning point in his life, fundamentally altering his focus and priorities. It sounds like a truly seismic experience.
He described a deep sense of interconnectedness, a feeling of oneness with the universe, and an expanded state of consciousness that even included an out-of-body sensation, despite not being in any life-threatening situation. It was a completely unexpected and life-altering moment that really shook his worldview.
This experience propelled him into a two-decade-long personal and intellectual exploration into the nature of consciousness. This wasn't just a casual interest. It was a deep and rigorous inquiry fueled by extensive study and meditation, all while still leading Synaptics. He was, in essence, leading a double life during this period, balancing the practical demands of a tech CEO with his profound philosophical quest.
And his extensive research led him to a firm conviction. Consciousness cannot simply be an emergent property of inert matter. He uses the analogy of electricity and magnetism, pointing out that they don't spontaneously arise from atoms without charge or spin. The idea of consciousness magically appearing from purely physical processes seemed like an insufficient and ultimately flawed explanation to him.
Right. And at the time, the scientific community largely considered the topic of consciousness to be outside the bounds of mainstream scientific inquiry, almost a taboo subject. Yet Faggin, driven by his own powerful experience and his relentless intellectual curiosity, persisted in his investigation. That takes immense intellectual courage, doesn't it?
It really does. This conviction led him and his wife, Elvia, to establish the Federico and Elvia Faggin Foundation, dedicated to the scientific study of consciousness. It's a testament to their strong partnership that Elvia, despite her initial skepticism, became a steadfast supporter and collaborator in this deeply personal endeavor.
Federico firmly believes, based on his extensive studies, that machines do not possess consciousness and fundamentally never will. His reasoning centers on the idea that they are not living systems, which he believes are fundamentally quantum systems. The prevailing notion that life equals machine like a computer is, in his view, fundamentally incorrect. It's a very strong statement based on his deep investigation.
His thinking goes even further, proposing that all matter possesses a form of consciousness, not at the level of individual particles, but at the level of underlying quantum fields. This is a significant departure from conventional scientific thought and opens up some fascinating avenues of exploration.
His current work involves a new theory of consciousness called quantum information panpsychism, developed in collaboration with Italian physicist Giacomo D'Ariano. This theory posits that a fundamental conscious quantum field with inherent free will underlies all of reality. Quantum information represents inner experience, and the collapse of the wave function represents the exercise of free will. It's a radical and, well, thought-provoking perspective.
It's a fascinating reversal of conventional thinking, where he posits that consciousness is primary, the very foundation from which mathematics and the physical world arise, rather than being a product of them. It was his profound personal experience that triggered this fundamental shift in his understanding, revealing the limitations of the purely materialist view he had once held. And don't forget to stay tuned until the end for a final thought-provoking question.
And we must also acknowledge the crucial role of his wife, Elvia. When Federico left Intel to pursue his entrepreneurial ambitions, the company regrettably attempted to minimize his pivotal contributions. Elvia bravely and fiercely defended his legacy, ensuring his groundbreaking work was properly recognized.
Yes, she founded the Silicon Valley Italian School and worked as a journalist, strategically using these platforms to ensure that Federico's crucial role in inventing the microchip was accurately documented and attributed. She was a tireless champion for his achievements.
Beyond that, she has been an unwavering source of support, not only for his groundbreaking entrepreneurial ventures, but also for his later more unconventional pursuit of understanding consciousness. Theirs is truly a remarkable and inspiring partnership.
So let's pause and reflect on the truly extraordinary journey we've explored. Federico Faggin, from a childhood shaped by the complexities of wartime Italy to becoming a central architect of the digital revolution, and then, in a profound and unexpected turn, a deep and dedicated explorer of the very nature of consciousness. It's a life story that's almost hard to believe.
We've touched on those pivotal, almost shocking moments. The invention of the microchip that changed the world. The intense struggle for the recognition he deserved. And that profound personal transformation at Lake Tahoe that redirected the course of his life's purpose.
And it all originates from his Italian roots, that inherent ingenuity and relentless pursuit of understanding that has left an indelible mark on the global stage. His story is one that deeply resonates with an international audience that admires the brilliance and vision that can emerge from Italy. Like, comment, and subscribe to our channel for more inspiring stories of Italian excellence.
And now for that final provocative thought. Considering Federico Faggin's truly remarkable journey, what are the profound implications if consciousness is, in fact, more fundamental than matter? How might this radical shift in perspective reshape our understanding of technology, of ourselves, and of the very fabric of the universe, potentially opening up possibilities we haven't even begun to contemplate?
It's a deeply thought-provoking question, one that invites us to really explore the very foundations of our understanding of reality, and the potential that might lie beyond our current comprehension. We encourage you to delve deeper into these concepts and to reflect on your own perspectives on the nature of consciousness.
Thank you for joining us on this deep dive into the life and mind of an undeniable icon of Italy.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel so you won't miss the next videos.